on it, so I will have included that. Hopefully we'll be able to do what the material I have, we'll be able to go through that in 1 hour. We'll see how that goes. So the basic thing is just to introduce you to bioeconomic modeling, very simple bioeconomic models as a start, so people can build on those who want to. And then I did a game theory and shared stocks. The main reason why game theory is seen as a very good tool in fisheries analysis is that a lot of fish stocks are shared by many countries, many entities, different stakeholders. And whenever you have that kind of sharing, and when you have more parties interested in something, game theory is seen as a good analytical framework to do that. So I'll play around with that. So this is our fishery system. This is a tell you that, wow, there's a lot of fish in the ocean. could be more.
More technologically advanced.
Yeah, you could be more technologically advanced, even with the same manuals, you're just able to find the fish under the rocks and whatever, right? That could be it. And it could also be that you have a lot of fish in the ocean, you know. So there are many things that you can learn from trends in CPUE. And people do a lot of this analysis for different fishes, mostly biologists. This is data from the FAO about the trend in catch over time from 1950 to now. 1950 is a very important year for people in the fisheries, those of us working at the global level, because that's the year that the FAO started collecting data on behalf of the world, global fisheries, all countries are compiling, they got the mandate to do that. And so you have some data, it's not very good, it's not the best, but that's the picture we have, and you can see how catch has been growing from 1950 and to recently, where we see some stability almost getting to the end. So when you look at this catch data, what do you say? We've been catching a lot and increasing, and now it's stabilizing. What does it tell you about the state of global fisheries? Does this tell you anything? If you just look at this picture.
After 1990, the
reached a saturation level? Yeah, so it's stable like this. And can you say something about that? When you go in like that and suddenly you're stabilized, does it tell you something about the biology, about the fish in the ocean?
You reached the maximum point
of life. It looked like you're hitting the maximum that your fish can take, right? You can deduce something from this. When I put this thing up, the question I have is, why is this, right? The biology is the possible answer, but some people tell me maybe it's because we don't fish hard like before. We're taking more fish, we're having fun, right? So, especially fishing industry, fishing companies may tell you that, oh, it's too much management, so we're not allowed to go out and really fish hard as we would. So what we do is, look at what happens, that's the point you made when you reach the top, and then we estimate the fishing effort accumulated over time. This is a very new paper that just came up, Greg Larson, the leader of that. So this is effective fishing effort for, according to our estimate, the trend. So you see similar trend is going up, and it's still going up, while the catch is stabilizing. So now, they cannot tell me it's because we are taking holidays, right? It shows that we're fishing even harder and still catching stability. Then you start really having a feel about what is happening in the ocean.
So is that effective effort trying to normalize for things like improved technology and...
Yeah, exactly. So for example, do I have in the CD 2.242, that is the effort, the power, ability to catch due to technology. Somebody has estimated per year there is an improvement of about 2% of our ability to catch fish, and that is built into this. It's similar to the oil, the big oil business, right? It's similar. And this is a very important point. So people argue with us sometimes, oh, the fish is doing well. And then I sit and say, how is that possible? How can fisheries be doing well when we know oil is not doing well? When we know we're pumping too much CO2, right? When we know languages are being decimated, So you look at all the phenomena, there's one trend, right? So fish cannot suddenly be fine. You see the point I'm making? It's just not possible. You don't need any detailed modeling to really have a feeling where fish is doing. If you look at how oil is doing, how forest is doing, how CO2 pumping is doing, tells you that the trend has to be the same, except you are living in Mars with your fish, right? That's the same rules that apply. So that's a good point. And you can plot the CPUE. I don't have a figure for it, but you can have an idea, right? So how does it look? It starts somewhere there, and then I think it probably increases in the one to get into the end. You can easily do this, divide the two, and you have your CPUE. So CPUE can tell you something. Can tell you something about what is happening in the ocean, in the technology, and so on. And if you are an economist, actually, see, the catch gives you an idea of the potential revenue you can make, right? Everything being equal, more fish you catch, the more money you make, right? If it's the same type of fish and the price is constant. So, and the effort can tell you something about the cost of fish. So this is a very rough bioeconomic model of the fishery that biologists use a lot because they don't want to get into prices and costs and so on. And this tells them something about the revenue side and the cost side in a very rough way. But of course, it's not the full story, right? So that's this, yeah. Now, let's get into economics. If you look at classic management problems, and most of us are aware of this, there's overfishing in most places. Some places have no well, it's not all around. Overcapacity is the reason, we just have too much fishing effort going out of the fish, even the nature. And this leads to low profits and in some places negative profits actually. So the fishing enterprises or businesses that are really fishing with negative profit. And you ask me, why are they doing that, right? Doesn't that come to your mind? Why will you fish when you don't make money? Anybody can explain? Why is that possible? If you're a business person,
Subsidies,
yes. So if you have an uncle or auntie who is giving you money, when you are in trouble, they ship you money, then you can keep going. And I know there are some businesses in the developing world in particular where this happens. Raghu maybe will know this. So you have an auntie who has a little business, right? And you are living in Canada, right? So she has a shop. So she's doing the business, but it's rather negative, right? Because anyone in the family can just come and take milk without paying, right? So 6 months into the business, she's in red, and then sends a letter to Raghu, somebody, and then some money comes in, she fills up the shop, right? So the business can go on once you can keep getting that flowing. That's what subsidies does. So that's a solid one, and we've seen that there's a lot of subsidies being paid. All right, any other reason why you run a business with a negative?
In the hope that things will improve, you get a few years of left back in profit?
Absolutely, yeah. So you are running a business that runs through time, right? So yeah, you say, okay, if you look at any point in time, I can take on some losses with the hope that I'll make that up. So yeah, that is also, we see that in the data a lot, yeah. So in anticipation. And this can turn out to be correct, and you get back into the black, but you might just keep going now. And before you know, you're bankrupt, right? So, yeah.
I think there is also, especially in traditional businesses, there's also some sort of inertia that you will be doing that, your father was doing that, your grandfather was doing that, so you will not be the one to stop the business, even though the business is not
Profitable. Exactly. So, fishing is a way of life, and people say that. So, we can fish in anything. But you can only do that really in the long run if there is something backing you up, right? That is key. In developing countries, what we see is that because of the lack of alternative employment, if you look at the pure profit as economists do, you see a negative, but actually it's not a negative because the opportunity cost of labor is zero, actually, right? So if you put the wages the fishes earn, you see a negative zero, but for them, that is not really economic thing they look at because the alternative is zero, so they put zero, and that can turn your negative into positive if that is your situation. So there is a deep economic reason why this can also go on. Yeah. Okay. So, can you predict the above using only CPUE or fishing mortality models? My answer is no. You just cannot do it. You need a bit more economics. And so, we will, as our entry into bioeconomic models. And bioeconomic models have been used to predict all of these things. That you have overcapacity if you have subsidies. And if you have overcapacity, you will overfish your stock. So let's see how that comes through. And all these management problems are very undesirable. This is the problem of this thing. Nobody likes to overfish, actually. Even those who overfishing don't want to overfish. But unfortunately, the economics is saying that. you are driven into doing that. Mainly because it's a common pool resource.